You know, thanks for what you do with your podcast and all the rest. You're doing a great job. Hope everybody keeps tuning in. You get a lot of good info, a lot of insights, understandings of how to get strong, how to stay strong, how to use your strength.
You do a great job, dude. You make things better than they are in real life, I think.
If you don't follow Massonomics, y'all do it. Social media, website, everything.
Massonomics!
Welcome back, everyone, for episode 254 of the Massonomics Podcast. We are the lifting podcast about nothing. My name is Tanner.
And my name is Tommy.
We're coming to you recording live from Western, Northeast, South Dakota. Again, as always, no changes there. We haven't moved yet.
Still haven't relocated the headquarters.
No, not yet. We're going to save that for after our 5-year anniversary, yeah. I guess. Tommy, I had supper today at this little Italian restaurant. I was curious if you know about it. It's I know we've got one in our town. I don't know that this is a chain necessarily. It might just be just this little hole in the wall Italian place that we have special here in Western Northeast South Dakota. I think you pronounce it Little Caesars.
I think I've heard of that. Yeah. It's actually funny you say that. My mother-in-law was just telling me how she had Little Caesars a week ago, and she goes, "That's not very good pizza, is it?" I'm like, oh, no, it is not.
It is low quality. They have one.
I used to do this thing for me in my single days, you know, yeah. when you don't have a family Batching to worry about it. Or any of that. Yeah. It was like Fridays was get super amped because it's the weekend, so you would get done. It was squat day. You yeah. get to the gym. You get super amped. You get your squat workout in, and then it's like, all right, what am I going to get in my base and my system before I go out and party with my friends? And for a long time, it was Wendy's, uh-huh. and Wendy's is always great and an amazing option, but occasionally yeah. you need to switch it up. And I did Little Caesars for a while, and after like a month of that, so you'd get the pizza, you'd try to eat as much as you can,
yep.
you'd get done, you'd be like, wow, I don't feel good right now. This isn't a good place to be.
No.
And so that it's probably been a couple of years. Yeah. It's for sure been at least 3 years since I've had Little Caesars.
There's a funny Little Caesars meme page out there. I don't know
really?
What it's called for sure. Someone can find that. And I think it's quite popular too. And it's like a faux Little Caesars. And it's all just kind of like all plays on how it is kind of just like extremely cheap and crappy.
Yeah. You know, I'm not going to say that if someone put Little Caesars in front of me, I wouldn't eat it. I would definitely eat it. And I don't think it's like disgusting.
No,
just
it makes you feel,
after
it just
when
makes
you're
you
done,
feel
you're
disgusting.
Just like, yeah, like, yeah, you
Trust
get that.
Me, I know.
Yeah. So you just wanted to revisit the feeling, make sure yeah. it was still there. Yeah.
Yes. And speaking of Little Caesars, today's show is brought to you by Lifting Large. Lifting Large has set a new standard for customer service within the strength world. They have live website chat support and speedy email responses. Lifting Large is home of the Groundlock deadlift slipper, and they are always in stock and ready to ship. Massonomics listeners can save 20% on all Lifting Large branded products by using our discount code MASS20 at checkout. Today's episode is also brought to you by Spud Inc. The goal of Spud Inc. Straps is to make products that support sports performance and help everyone achieve their training goals. They make products that last forever, won't bust your budget, and most importantly, leave no doubt about success when everything is on the line. Check them out online at spud-ink-straps.com. The show is also brought to you by Texas Power Bars. In 1980, Buddy Capps set out on his own to make what he believed was the greatest bar he had ever seen and trained with, and the Texas Power Bar was born. It was strong as a house with the best knurling, and it was maintenance-free. Hundreds of state, national, international, world, and Western, Northeast, South Dakota powerlifting records have been and continue to be set and broken on the Texas Power Bar. To learn more, visit them at texaspowerbars.com. And this episode is brought to you by Hybrid Performance Method. They're your one-stop shop for all things fitness and online coaching, whether goals are training-related, nutrition and body composition-related, or both. Hybrid has a program for you. With dedicated and experienced coaches in each strength and fitness discipline, you can rest assured that you're in the best hands possible. Use our discount code there when you check out. It's MASS, M-A-S-S, in all caps. And that will save you 5% off any training or nutrition membership for the entire life of your membership at hybridperformancemethod.com. Those are our sponsors.
Wow. Still there.
Yep, still there, all four of them. So today we're going to talk about, exciting new contest.
Yep.
Exciting new contest, the Massonomics contest.
Mm-hmm.
That's very exciting. We're going to talk about more
USAPL fun stuff.
We have a special guest for this episode, Daniel McKim.
We have a can.
We have a can segment.
There we go. Your next 2 hours are all booked up.
All right, perfect. How about that can segment?
Should we crack into a cold one?
Little Caesars brewing still.
All right. Something to wash well, Tanner, this is a what's in the can, so okay. I'm going to need you to put your thinking hat
okay.
on.
Okay. Oh, it's been a while since I've really
yep.
Here really tried we to play go. This game. Oops. Dropped the cues. Oh, it's a she's long and skinny.
Yep. Okay.
Sniff. Oh. Fruity.
Okay.
Very aromatic.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, it tastes good. I like it. I do like it. Do I know what it is? No. Mm-hmm. Do I like it? Yes. Let me take another sip of this.
And Tanner is thinking. He is thinking.
That's
so
a good,
hard right now.
Flavorful beverage.
Mm-hmm.
I guess we're in the sparkling water family. Mm-hmm. It's tall and skinny. I don't know. It feels like it's packs more of a punch than a LaCroix. It makes me think of the fancy LaCroix
yep.
by the shape of the can, but yep. the flavor is more robust.
Yeah. Okay. Okay.
And what the flavor is, let me try that one more time.
you're getting me more and more excited as we go here, Tanner, because I feel like you're just so close.
I really am having a hard time putting my finger on that flavor. Let me try one more sip to see if something comes to me in the 11th hour here. God, I cannot pair that.
Just
something
can't
I've
quite
had
verbalize
before,
it. It's just not quite there.
To me, it's like tropical punch is like the one flavor I can put my, what I could say, tropical. Not just a fruit punch, but a tropical punch blend.
Are you ready to take a
yeah,
look?
Yeah, let's see.
Go ahead and look there.
Oh. Huh. What? This has alcohol in it?
Yeah, this does, in fact, have alcohol
in it. I did not know. I was so wrong in so many ways.
I thought there was a pretty good chance you would get that part, but I didn't know for sure. So this is a peach pear Michelob Ultra Organic
wow.
Seltzer.
I honestly could not tell that this had alcohol in it. Let me see now that I know if I can.
I think maybe you'll say that now. Like, I think that's part of the robustness.
Boy, as far as these goes, this is the least that I can tell that has alcohol in it. It yep. makes sense being a Michelob Ultra.
And seltzer. I really should have done a better job of researching this, but I did. I can't take all the credit for this because someone told me that this will trick you so hard. And yeah. now I can't. We've had so many cans lined up. Oh, here we go. Here we go. Hunter Peterson at HD Peterson 19. Thank you for the suggestion. He said Michelob Ultra is coming out with seltzers that will surely stump Tanner in the what's in the can segment. You can't tell that they are 4% alcohol at all. And the flavors are very subtle.
I agree. I cannot tell that. I still have a hard time telling this has alcohol in it.
I just said, like, I told my wife, I'm like, can you imagine if stuff like this existed when you were first trying to drink alcohol?
Boy, like, you'd be like, hello. Like,
you mean you don't have to chug UV blue to try?
Right. I mean, yes. It would have been probably beneficial. Like, I could have just got less drunk because instead of, like just buying a fifth of straight liquor and figuring out whatever way you could choke it down.
Yeah. So not too bad, huh?
No, that's good.
You know, they're as I don't think of Michelob Ultra as being a premium brand as far as price goes, you know?
Right.
But I think a 12 pack was like $16, which isn't exactly cheap for these things. But they are tasty.
Yeah. So is it all peach pear or is it an assortment?
I don't know if I should tell you that, Tanner. There actually is an assortment. It is
that's good though, because you don't want six. That would now, be my biggest thing. Like, I drink one of these and I'd be like, all right, I need a different flavor.
And that's also my thing. I'm not, you know, we talk about it every week. We always have these sparkling waters. I like sparkling water, but I also don't like drinking multiple sparkling waters. No. Like, to me, one sparkling water is like the right amount.
Yeah.
And that's why I'm not really a seltzer guy, is like one is fine. But I don't like, and this is good, but I don't really want to drink 3, 4, 5 or more of these.
So is a seltzer a sparkling water with alcohol in it then?
I don't know if that's what the actual definition is or not.
But that's the way that they're marketing.
I mean, that's just when my brain hears seltzer, I think alcohol sparkling water, basically.
Yeah.
And every company has one now.
Right, right, yeah.
From like Natural Light to Keystone to Bud Light. I mean, every company has their own now.
What was the one that really... White Claw. White Claw was.
I feel like they really kickstarted the revolution.
Right, right.
And who knows? There's probably people before them even, but
Totally stumped.
I thought you would have maybe got the peach pear thing.
I don't know. It was just maybe it's been too long since I've had peach pear. I don't know how to describe that. Or maybe it's the slight alcohol that just
that could be it. There was just enough there to throw you off. So we did totally stump Tanner this week.
How many?
You know, as far as a seltzer goes, I think I'd probably give this a 4.
I can't imagine
many seltzers being much better.
I don't think so either.
I've compared it to a few, and in my limited experience, this is one of the best ones I've ever had.
Oh, it's good.
All right. Next up on the list, Tanner. Should we talk powerlifting stuff first and then the Massonomics announcement?
Yeah, because everyone is excited about the Massonomics contest announcement, so let's leave them on. So, leave them hanging.
I like that. So, Johnny Candido just needs to keep coming out with videos every week because he brings all these things to my attention wasn't aware about. So the one that he brought up this week, I think he said something about how he's done. I think the video was like titled, I'm done with the USAPL or something like that. Or why he's not competing in Raw Nationals. I think that's what it was. And one of the things that he talks about was, or as far as having a bone to pick with them, beef with them, was their lifetime membership. And I was like, I've never heard of this. This is... like my ears peaked up a little bit. Right. What's going on here? What's this all about? And he starts talking about it and you go, no, that's actually real. So Tanner, I have the information here for the USAPL lifetime membership, which on the surface I would say isn't a bad idea. Like if that's the Fed you want to compete in and they want to offer a lifetime membership, why not? You know,
and I typically would consider a lifetime membership to be a bar. You would do it because you're getting a good deal.
Yeah. Usually that's what you do. So the, the lifetime membership, actually, regular, maybe it makes more sense to say what a regular membership costs first. So here, according to their annual registration, it expires on the 31st of every year. You know, they're good for the entire year. The open division, open, masters, junior, all your divisions are $65 a year, unless you're a teen or a youth. Or Special Olympian, those ones are anywhere from 20 to 40. So for most people listening to this,
65.
You're paying $65 a year to compete in the USAPL, which however you feel about Federation membership fees, I guess $65. It's pretty minimal in the scheme of things.
Yeah, like seems standard-ish.
Yeah, I don't think that's that crazy. But then, a lifetime membership. So brings up the question of like right away my brain goes, well, what's a lifetime? Like to me, 20 years of competing kind of seems like a lifetime of competing
would be a lot
for most people. That is more than a lifetime. Yeah. 20 years at, you know, if we bring out the old handy dandy calculator here, Tanner, and just say 20 years times 65, that's 1300.
Yeah.
So then my brain's going, 1300, that's the retail price. So it's gotta be less than that. So maybe 1000, but even that maybe seems a little high, right?
Yeah.
That's just what my brain did right away. the lifetime membership, so it does change based on your age, which I guess they want to make sure that they're getting their money out of you. At the youngest age, 17 to 22, the lifetime membership costs $2,437. If you start to move up that age bracket, more in age range, Tanner, like in your 30s, you're still looking at about
that one would have been 37 years of competing.
okay
assuming the price never went
so
up,
yeah so I'm actually going to turn 32 in just a couple of weeks here, and I would be in the 2259.
It barely went down.
Yeah, so what is that divided by
35 years?
So that would mean that I have to compete
till you're 60
every year until I'm 67 for it to pay off, which is great. Like that's such a, that like, is that 0.001% of all competitors?
Yeah, I mean, nobody. Like, you can maybe find one that fits in that bracket.
And even, I mean, even if you're 40 years old, it's still $2,000, which I'm curious, just out of, for the math, does that still come out to be 67? 2,000 divided by 65, right. 30 years. And that's if you're 40 years old. So you got to be, you got to live until you're 70 to, for it to pay off if you're 40.
It gets worse the older, it's really a worse deal the older you are.
Yeah, so that's pretty insane. And then where a lot of people were having issues, and I think, like, well, Johnny Candido was obviously talking about the price being a thing, but he also did bring up the fact that this year's Raw Nationals, I believe it was like the top five people have preference as far as being invited and there to compete. And after that, it doesn't matter where you rank in the world, unless though you do have a lifetime membership, you do get preference into getting in.
So you're just buying yourself a trip to Nationals.
Yeah, which is pretty lame. And then you can look on here and they do have a lifetime membership terms and conditions. And with that, they have the member benefits. So you do get a personalized lifetime member jacket, which
members only.
I mean, the jacket could honestly be $300 or more. Like, right. Jackets could cost a lot. You get a personalized ID card, which, let's be honest, that costs nothing. a member embroidered patch, let's be honest, costs nothing again. Lifetime member pin costs nothing. Distinctive lifetime member decals. Those are things. These are things that we sell or in the market of buying. We know you can get all those things for, like, dollars. Free spectator entry to all USA Powerlifting Nationals. But again, why do you need to buy a membership to get a membership for a competitor and use it to be a spectator? It kind of doesn't make sense, sort of. And then a 5% discount on courses and seminars.
5%.
And a 5% discount on your entry for nationals. I don't know what a national entry costs, but
and you become a AAA auto member. So if you get a flat tire, it covers you for that.
So this, I don't know. It's one of those things that maybe they had good intent. I feel like what they need to do is they need to hire just some regular average Joes, Tanner, like us right here, to be like on their board of consultants.
And just be like, does this make sense to you?
Hey, guys, we got an idea.
No. Terrible idea. Like, this is so stupid.
We can represent the average lifter and just be like, all right, how many people will go for this? And if it's like, best case scenario, 1%, maybe?
How's this idea sign? Do you think people are going to rag on us for this? Yeah. Like, is this terrible PR?
Yeah, let's think. What is the best case scenario? Okay, best case scenario is we got 1% of our membership base to do this. That would be absolute best case. I'm sure it's like 0.1%. What's the worst case scenario? People talk about it on shows like this and on YouTube and like trash it and just make us look really, really dumb. Is it worth that risk? And they must have went, yeah, it's worth that risk. Like, which seems so stupid, right?
Yes.
But that seems like a pretty logical argument to have with yourself right there, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So they must have did that. I guess if you want to give them the benefit of the doubt, you would say they did that. And they were still like, fuck it. Doesn't matter.
We want the money. I guess it's just a money play then.
Maybe.
So then the other issue is the Nationals thing, like that giving you a seat. But so is the Nationals qualification just weird this year because of COVID and there being a lack of competitions for the year?
I think.
And then it'll go back to normal after that.
But what is normal? Because doesn't that...
You're total.
But I'm saying even normal, though, is still like we let a lot of people in.
Right, but I think they have been increasing that.
They have, too. But it still
eventually, is... Eventually, if they at least keep continuing to increase it, you know, like they haven't probably made the one drastic increase, but like if they can keep progressing those numbers, eventually that'll get more reasonable, I suppose.
Eventually, I think.
Yeah.
You would hope. Or maybe just you need more annual memberships, lifetime memberships.
Yeah, right.
It could be either way. We'll never know, I guess.
So that's the latest USAPL.
Latest federation news. There hasn't been much federation news lately, has there?
No. There hasn't been much good federation news for like the USAPL.
There honestly hasn't been much powerlifting news in general.
That's true.
Kind of a down year, I guess, with everything going on.
With everything going on, that's actually a good caveat to that.
All right. Should we talk about more fun stuff?
Yes.
Okay.
Masonomic stuff.
This. I'm rubbing my hands together. We are excited about this. So we are happy to announce that we are launching another Masonomics contest. And now before you go, another Masonomics contest. Okay, this one is different. We've been doing several. The last contest we had, we always like to have a good contest. Mm-hmm. It's fun for us. It's fun for the for the community
involved.
People win cool prizes. The last several though have been video based, and we've loved it. There's been some amazing submissions, and we've got to know a few people in the Massonomics world very well through them.
Yes,
but in order to change things up a little bit, hopefully get
curveball.
Yeah,
this might be a curveball.
Yeah, there's no spin on this thing. No, it's a knuckleball, but it still moves. We are doing a new contest, and this one is the best Massonomics meme. We want people to see the meme, and the big thing here is no videos allowed. Videos are not part of it. It has to be a picture.
Yes.
Or I guess
an image. Yeah,
you know, a standard meme.
Yes.
And with this contest, so what is the meme about, Tanner? What do you make a meme about in this contest?
Anything Massonomics related, however you interpret that. What would be some popular topics that we would think?
Well, right away.
Yeah.
And so these might be the low-hanging fruit. These might not be good, but
right.
Lift shorts joke, throwaway culture, Jefferson deadlifts.
Western, Northeast, South Dakota.
Now, that's not to say those won't be good and couldn't be winners. They could be. But a lot of people are going to be thinking those same things, so just be careful there.
Right, right.
You got to bring your A game if you're going to make memes about
that. You know, if you're
going
to make a lift shorts meme, it probably better be pretty funny.
I mean, we have no doubt made hundreds of them already, so you got to add something new to that conversation if you're going to do it. But this with the image format, a lot of people don't feel comfortable being on video, and we understand. It's you know, we have to look at ourselves on video every week, and I mean, we know that's a train wreck, so we get why people don't want to be on video.
Yes.
Some people are very, very good at it in our audience.
Yes.
There's no doubt about that. But
this gives a lot of those other people a good fighting chance that maybe felt like they were.
And it's also I'm not going to say it's easier from a thinking process, because a well thought out meme can take a lot of time to think about. But as far as the execution, putting together some words on a picture is usually a little easier than trying to set up your phone to film you or get someone to film you. So we're hoping that this gets some more people involved.
I think that would be my hope, is that we're going to get a whole slew of entries from this one.
And I think that that's very realistic. So when we get down to the real details of this thing here, Tanner, we wrote them out. There were so many details. We had to write them all out here. So
it is an Instagram-based competition.
This is an Instagram-based competition, and it is going to start on Sunday the 14th. So if you're a YouTube, if you're part of that first comment race on YouTube,
you got the jump.
You do got the jump start. So this is starting on Sunday the 14th. The 14th of February, 2021, and it's going to run through the whole week. So it will... The last day for entries is Sunday, the 21st of February. All your memes, they have to be Massonomics related. We don't want just your generic powerlifting motivation. Sumo is for cheaters.
You have to tie in.
There has to be something Massonomics. Yeah.
It doesn't have to be blatant either.
No.
But it just
can just be something we've talked about.
Right,
maybe
right.
one time.
Maybe, you know. Other ideas coming to mind as thinking farther.
Sparkling
apple
water.
Apple pie, sparkling water, LaCroix. You know, really, road to 300, road to 400, podcast reviews, podcasting. You know, there's almost an endless list.
Friends
there.
Of the podcast.
Yes, right.
There really is. Go back and look through our last 100 Instagram posts. You'll find all types of ideas.
Right.
Make sure you tag us. Like, you know, we got to be able to find this thing. So make sure you tag us and also use hashtag Massonomics meme.
That's key.
And unlimited entries are allowed.
Right.
Because that is the beauty of this is, because it does take a little less effort than putting a whole big video together.
Yep.
It's much easier to bang these things out. So if you have 10 great ideas, put 10 out there. We want to see them.
Yep. So do it needs to be posted with hashtag Massonomics meme. That's what you said, right?
Yep.
That's
what
we're going with.
Yep. Okay. Tag us at Massonomics and then hashtag Massonomics meme.
Yep.
That way you can get your name thrown into the hat
and
there.
What some people want to do, somebody will say, hey, can I just send you this? Like they'll want to DM it. And what's the rule? You can't do that. Then you need to post it with hashtag Massonomics meme to be considered as a winner.
Yeah, I guess technically if you're a private account, then it would need to be sent to us. But I don't know if there's really any other exception that we would make besides that.
I think in order to be considered a winner, it has to be posted with hashtag Massonomics meme, because that's how we're going to filter them.
Yeah, and it's like, it's the whole
thing.
If you want
to send them, go ahead and send them.
If a meme happens in a forest and no one's there to hear
it, does it really exist?
Yeah, so that's kind of the whole point here. So I do think, I think that is a good point, is that you don't just send it to us. You do have to post it on your story so we can find it. And we are going to pick So we did say unlimited entries for that week. We are going to pick our five favorites. So there's five winners in this one.
Yep.
And they're all going to get a $100 Massonomics prize pack.
All right. Very good.
Shirts, hats, clothes, gears, all that stuff.
Cool stuff. Probably not lift shorts. So.
Probably not. Let's be
I mean, it's
here.
Only $100. We said
$100. So, yeah. No one wants to
give
piece.
You part of a pair of yeah, lift shorts.
Actually, some people would probably
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I mean, so, it's like fractional shares.
Yeah. So we are very excited for that. I think there's going to be some grade A content.
Oh, I'm excited to start seeing them rolling
because we know we would have quit these contests a long time ago, but we know we got some really original and creative listeners out there.
I really am excited about this contest too. I think it provides an avenue to get a lot of people involved that have probably wanted to get involved and have creative ideas, but weren't down for the video thing. So I want to see a lot of those other Massonomics faithful.
I do too.
Get on this one.
And we're all about inclusivity over here, Tanner, especially when it comes to memes. No one should feel out in the out in the meme world.
No, and I bet with this format, we'll be able to see some new winners, some new winning faces that
some
we have
young bloods in the group here.
Yes, yes.
I think so. I think a new star could be born out of this.
Yeah, and this is no guarantee, but maybe just because we only know because we have done this now in the past, we have set a precedent. Maybe our favorite one could even get a couple minute call on the Massonomics podcast.
Yeah.
Not guaranteed, but maybe.
Yeah. Well, you know, we make the rules. If someone's going to blow us away, we could change this whole thing up.
Yes.
Maybe we decide only one person's going to win because it's so good.
Right.
Probably not. But
no, right.
I mean, we're in control here. We can do what we want.
We decide.
So I'm very excited for this. We'll probably start posting. I would imagine this is only a week. You know, with the videos, we give people more time because it does take a lot more to do it.
Right.
I would imagine already early in the week, we're going to be getting
Monday, I think
getting
some
banger submissions, and those are going to be getting posted right away for people to see.
And we don't give any preference in our picking of the winner of whether you sent it early or late, but I just probably wouldn't wait because there's going to, you know, you start to this is almost like the same meme.
Yeah, if it ever comes down to a tiebreaker, it usually does go to the first person because it feels more original.
Right. Yes. And we'll start sharing them, you know, on our page and our stories and get as many of them out there as we can.
Yeah. So, but don't sit around. There's unlimited entries.
That's
so if you come up with another idea, just get it out there.
Yep. Just send that to us then too.
It's going to be good, Tanner.
It's going to be really good.
I almost won't be able to sleep tonight thinking about
it. Well, we won't be able to sleep for
a week straight.
Yeah.
I'll have to be drinking Michelob Ultra Peach Pear Seltzers to calm my nerves that whole week, you know?
This is the only way I get to bed anymore. Peach Pear Seltzer.
Mm. Refreshing.
Ah.
All right, should we hop into some ads here?
Let's do it.
Okay, the Massonomics podcast is brought to you by Spud Inc. and the Neck Harness. Whether you need a strong neck for your sport or you just want a freaky strong neck, the Spud Inc. Neck Harness can get you there. Made from soft but extremely durable webbing and fully adjustable via industrial strength Velcro, the Neck Harness is the strongest, most comfortable neck trainer out there. Perform traditional neck exercises by attaching the harness to plate weight or get creative with bands, sleds, or anything else you can think of. You can get the Neck Harness online at spud-inc-straps.com. This episode is also brought to you by Hybrid Performance Method. Whether you've been training without a coach and have been looking for a competitive edge, remember to check out hybridperformancemethod.com. Hybrid has 15 different strength and fitness programs covering everything from powerlifting and strongman to gymnastics and general fitness, all included in one training membership. That's not all. Hybrid also offers personalized nutrition coaching that uses lifestyle habits and a flexible approach to shape your nutrition plan around your current lifestyle instead of turning your lifestyle upside down in order to support unsustainable habits that only work in the short run the way most programs do. If you're ready to take your training, nutrition, or both to the next level, use code MASS, that's M-A-S-S, in all caps for 5% off membership to all programs for the life of your membership. Today's show is also brought to you by Texas Power Bars. Buddy Capps first started lifting weights in the late 60s and began powerlifting in the mid-70s. At the time, he was working for Image Barbell building gym equipment. Around 1976, a local machine shop started making bars for them, calling it the Image Bar. In 1977, Image Barbell became Champion Barbell. It was then that Buddy started looking at the bars with an intent of changing them for the better. In 1979, Buddy bought his first lathe to begin addressing the known issues. In 1980, His passion, drive, and purpose now had a greater mission. Buddy set out on his own to make what he believed was the greatest bar he'd ever seen and trained with, and the Texas Power Bar was born. It was strong as a house with the best knurling and was maintenance-free. Hundreds of state, national, international, world Massonomics, and Western Northeast South Dakota powerlifting records have been and continue to be set and broken on the Texas Power Bar. To learn more about Texas Power Bars and buy one of their legendary bars, visit texaspowerbars.com. And today's show is also brought to you by Lifting Large. Lifting Large is proud to announce the winners of their 2021 sponsored athlete contest. Tanner, that was so good, we had to announce them 2 weeks in a row.
Yeah, we wanted just to give these people a little extra love.
Just in case someone missed out.
Yep.
The winners are Molly from Hillsboro, Oregon, Amber from Alexandria, Virginia, Tara from British Columbia, Canada, Nathaniel from Sandy, Utah, Tommy from Antioch, California. I think that's how you say that place. And last but definitely not least, Mr. Brandon Amos from Eureka, California.
Of course.
Friend of Massonomics.
Yes, friend of the podcast.
Friend of the podcast. Each one of these winners received a $750 gift certificate from Lifting Large, along with a box full of goodies, groundlock deadlift slippers. And we selected they were selected from over 750 entries from strength athletes all around the world. And as you can imagine, it was hard to pick just six. Check out Lifting Large for all of the lifting gear. They supply powerlifters across the world. They also have the largest selection of Titan support systems equipment, groundlock deadlift slippers, ER combo racks, and all that good stuff. Check them out online at liftinglarge.com, and you can follow them on Instagram at liftinglarge.com. That's at liftinglarge, D-O-T-C-O-M. Thank you to our sponsors.
I'm trying to post an Instagram story right now, so this podcast stuff is just going to have to wait.
Put the podcast on hold, everyone. Yes. Tanner is busy.
Sometimes Instagram stories really can take a little while to load. Oh, there we go. We're good.
It's all the data crunching.
Yep.
Okay. Cloud, Tanner. It's the cloud.
Should we get our guest for today's episode, Mr. Daniel McKim, on the phone?
Let's do it.
There we go. Moment of truth.
All right. So far, so good. Does he know your numbers from South Dakota, Tanner?
I hope so.
All has been forwarded to
God, really?
Let's see. I guess we try him again now. Usually, whenever it doesn't work on the first try, every time we've tried the second try,
it has worked.
It has always worked.
Which means statistically, it shouldn't work one of these times here.
And as we're talking now, I'm just kind of just stalling just to give it like
a couple seconds
in the crapper or something.
Yeah.
Or also like, you know, sometimes when people call you like you're on the phone with someone else and they call you and like,
I get it already.
Like I'm
going
the
to
phone.
Answer. Yeah. Give me a second.
So try not to be that guy too, but I don't know.
Let's be honest. We have a show to run.
That's
true.
So we better try him again. What do we do if he doesn't answer though?
Boy. We have some audibles in our back pocket, I suppose. We can just start running through phone calls.
That's true. We can just start calling people.
I tell you what, dude, I'm such a loser trying to figure out my headphones.
We gave a little extra time on the call back just in case you were on the John or something like that.
No, you know, here I am just a sales guy and can't even figure out my stupid Bluetooth headphones.
Well,
way to go, McKim. I'm such an adult, I tell you.
It sounds good now, so you obviously did get it figured out.
No, I'm being like a doofus, holding it up to my ears. Like, I'm going to go dead. I'm going to have to change it back and forth. You know. You know how it goes.
You're going to get a good bicep pump.
Oh, yeah. Totally. Thankfully, I have small biceps, so this works out perfectly.
So who we have on the phone here is Daniel McKim. Our 30-second bio of you is we know you're four-time Highland Games champion of the world.
Of the world. There you go. Wow.
You are a Little Debbie ambassador on the Little Debbie lifting team.
Yep.
and I reversed the reverse order of importance here. That the Little Debbie part was actually slightly above the Highland Games World Championships, but.
Oh, clearly you've been talking to my kids because they feel that way.
You work with or for Soranex, which is also of interest to us. We always like a good talk of gym equipment. And you also, I believe, lead the charge on Deadcember, which just wrapped up here not too long ago.
Yeah. Not bad, fellas. Yeah, that's good. If I didn't know me better, I would be fairly impressed by that. But yeah.
And then I'm
just a weird meathead. So yeah.
And I suppose you're also a family man, and there's probably a bunch of non gym and non lifting related stuff involved in there, which is certainly important too.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, I've got five kids. Wife and I have five boys. So yeah, I just got some of them to bed, but they're still running around like wild men, like they usually are. So yeah, five boys live in northwest corner of Missouri. So when the weekend goes, Dan, come on, let's be serious. You don't live in North Missouri. You live in Southern Iowa. I'm like, yeah, that's a good way to put it. I'm like 5 miles from the Iowa border.
I don't know if you know it or not, but I honestly don't know if you know it, but you're really speaking our language right now, because we make a really big deal about what directions of the compass and where
we live.
Because we're actually from, what we like to say is we're from Western Northeast South Dakota is where we're from, which is actually accurate.
It is very accurate. And it happens to be, if you're not familiar with your directions, every direction on the map too.
Whoa. That's crazy.
But you being from Northwest Missouri, you know, in my head, I think of South Dakota and Missouri as not all that close, but really, especially if you go to Southeast South Dakota, you're not that far away from, say, Sioux Falls or Sioux City, Iowa. You know, it's not a long distance for you.
No, it's not bad at all. I mean, I can get up to Sioux Falls, Sioux City, maybe. It takes me about 3.5-4 hours, I think.
Okay.
I can't remember.
As far as Midwest travel goes, that's nothing.
No.
Right. Yeah. That's nothing, man.
So, all right. We should probably talk training for a minute here, and we just want to clear the air, just so you kind of understand what type of environment you're in.
You're dealing with.
Yeah, who you're dealing with here. Did we say 4-time world champion? Is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're also talking to Tanner's a multiple time Northeast South Dakota Class B Highland Games champion, and I am a multiple time competitor. So I feel like you should know who you're talking to.
Yeah, like
here.
So if we want to get into any like Highland Games specifics.
Like really, we can really talk shop for a little bit, I guess.
Since we're all on similar levels here.
Oh, okay. So we can really go down X's and O's. Right?
Yes. Like we get it. So we'll just, we're...
Okay, good.
That is funny and all true, but we have done a little bit of Highland Games ourselves. Like, I mean, more so we can have competed in powerlifting and strongman, but we do have a local Highland Games competition each year in our town, and it's fun for us. I would say it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
What years were you? Did you win the world championship? What years were you the best in the world?
Oh man, I won in 2011. 13, 15, and 17. Like, took a year off or something. I mean, the in-between years, I just couldn't quite get her done, so.
Okay. Were you, like, in those other years when you didn't win, were you, my assumption is that you were super competitive those years, in towards the top of the pack for probably a decade then?
Yeah, let's see, in 12, I finished third, and then 14, I was second, came down the last event. And then 16 was kind of weird. Our federation, as you guys know, with powerlifting and strongman, everyone's got to have a federation sometimes. So,
right.
And then you know how people get upset with each other. So it was kind of a bad deal with Highland Games. We kind of had a single sanctioned championship. And then things kind of fell apart. And so then we had two. So in 2016, I won one of them. And then I finished second at the other one.
Okay.
So I didn't get dubbed the champion that year, I guess.
Okay.
So what was, when you were competing, did you have like what was your event? What was your favorite event?
Sure. I love the caber toss. Okay. As you guys know, it was a long telephone pole type thing that you throw end over end.
Yep.
That was my favorite because that was the thing that everybody would come out for. It was done over lunchtime and the crowd. You can. That's one thing I learned when I first turned pro. I was really bad at a couple events, like not even a amateur level at a couple events. But I realized real quick, it's like, okay, this caber thing is kind of popular. So I just practiced the snot out of caber especially. And I could go and finish like mid of the pack, low of the pack when I first turned pro. But then, man, I would just smash cabers.
Uh-huh.
And people like, hey, man, that's so great. Here's my kid. Put this kid on my kid on your shoulder and take a picture with
yeah,
me.
Yeah.
I was like, thanks. I finished like sixth overall. Like, nah, man, you won the caber. You're the best in the world.
Right.
So, like, I learned that was a good way to get my name up there. So, but I would say that's my favorite. But the light hammer and the heavy hammer were my best events. 2014, I set the world record in both of those. So those were my better, more competitive events.
Okay. Tell me what your thought is on this, because we got a lot of listeners that probably haven't competed in Highland Games before, but would maybe consider dabbling in it, and that are strength athletes on some level. What I noticed from a lot of our crew that has gone and done these is that certain events we could kind of go and do pretty well at without being technicians of the sport.
Yeah, just having
regard.
A base level of strength will get you a ways.
And ones that I noticed sure. that for sure helped on was weight for height, because yeah. what I think you're standing in place and you can just
and also if you're bigger and just right, taller in right. general, that's just putting you up higher.
Right. So we've had a lot of people do well at the weight for height relative to maybe some people that are more technical in the sport. And then what else? I was gonna say the Braemar stone is the Braemar the heavier of the two? Is that right?
Where you yeah, just the heavy just it. Standing.
Yeah, because yep. there again, you're just standing and putting it. So I think that's an advantage for some people like us. And the weight for distance, absolutely not. Like that, especially like the heavy weight for distance. I feel like I've seen some of us just do embarrassing jobs at that event.
Yeah, you get that kink in the chain and things aren't going yeah. anywhere.
that is an event that you can take a big, strong guy that doesn't know that what they're doing and just make them look so stupid. Like just so
yep
that's but I've kind of noticed that I guess is that relatively accurate do you think?
Yeah, definitely. Those are by far the two. And what you get is you get the guy that's like a shot putter.
Yeah.
And they go out and they just like crush the stones. They're like, bro, these Highland Games are so easy. This is ridiculous. And then they go to the heavyweight for distance, like you said, and it was like, nah, I think I'm done. I don't want to do this anymore.
That's a great ego checker yeah. is the weight for distance.
Oh, dude, so true.
So has anyone ever won more than four times? I mean, is that the most that anyone's ever been the world champ?
No, the most is five.
Okay.
So Ryan Vieira, Matt Sanford, Jeff Capes, and Jim McGoldrick have all won five world championships.
Okay. Jeff Capes, that name sounds familiar. To me, is
he was a big time strongman.
Okay, okay, that's what I wondered if he
from
also,
yeah. the UK.
Okay,
so yeah,
cool. And then did you? Yeah, had you officially retired shortly within the last few years? Then from
yeah, I retired. I retired at the end of the 2017 season.
Okay, so you went out. You went out on top.
I did. I had the fortunate opportunity that the Worlds that year was in Holland. So it was awesome. They gave me a pair of clogs as a parting gift, which was like,
sounds really cool.
Oh, that's kind of crazy. But like, if you're just kind of a strong meathead dude, like it's pretty cool. Like they rolled out these monster clogs. And I'm like, that is really cool. I can't get those in Missouri.
That is real cool. What's
it was cool. It was an awesome time, man.
What would you rattle off of, a few of the cool places that you got to travel over your years of competing? What were some of the more fun places that you got to visit?
Oh man. Of course, Scotland. I went to Scotland three times. I went to France. Now that was, man, 2015 Worlds was in Bressuire. I'm sure if you have any French listeners, I'm sorry. Probably botched that, but it was in France. all I knew is it flew into Paris and then flew to another place and then had a long drive. But dude, we threw in the courtyard of a 1,000-year-old castle in France.
Yeah, that's really cool.
It was awesome.
Yeah.
It was so cool. And as a thrower, man, I was a thrower in college. You know, when the only people that show up to come watch you are grandma, grandpa, and your little brother, and he's playing with Legos half the time. Like, there's
right.
there's not really much interaction. And there, man, that first day, there was, like, I think 7,000 French people there, just, like, cool. yelling and screaming. And I didn't understand what they were saying other than, Dan McKim! Ha-ha, Dan McKim! And I was like, Vive la France! Vive la France! I mean, they're eating out of my hands. What can I say? You know? Yeah.
That's cool.
That was cool. The U.S. has been great, man. All, you know, all across the U.S. into Alaska from East Coast to West Coast. And that's what's kind of cool is, as you guys know, just being a Midwest kid, I grew up in a small town in Northwest Missouri. And, I mean, we drove. I'm a preacher's kid, so we couldn't fly anywhere. So we just drove to all the places we could go. And then the fact that now all of a sudden I got to throw, people were paying me to throw and paying me to go all over the country and all over the world to do it, like, kind of a dream come true, you know?
Yeah, that's something that a lot of people would love the opportunity to be able to do.
Did you threw in college then? Did you go to college? Did you stay in the Midwest for college then?
I did, hometown boy. I went to Northwest Missouri State University.
Okay.
If you guys are familiar with that, big football school mostly.
Yeah, okay, cool. Now, that was kind of one chapter of one thing we really wanted to talk to you about was some of your Highland Games experiences. But I don't know, Tommy, whether you agree, but I really want to know about the being a Little Debbie ambassador.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what everyone really wants to know. Like, what's going on here with this? Yeah. What is this exclusive club?
Yeah.
Oh, man. So, how much time do we have?
No. As much as it takes.
Well, I was, I've always loved Little Debbie snack cakes, right? I mean, I think every big guy always has. At least if you're in the Midwest or the South, you grew up on Little Debbie's.
Yes.
And so I have loved Little Debbie's. So over the years, I've shared my love for Little Debbie snack cakes on social media. And so just little things here and there. And so I'd put it out and... And long story short, one of my followers is actually the he's going to kill me if he hears this. He's the nephew. He's the nephew of Little Debbie herself.
Oh, and that is cool.
So, yeah, she's real, bro. Okay,
I did not know that. Yeah.
I didn't either.
Yeah.
And they had this thing on here like, you want to be a Little Debbie brand ambassador? Fill out this online application. So I filled it out like, you know, four times a day for like a month straight.
So just a modest number.
Exactly. I'm like, ding. Oh, yeah, there's my reminder. Got to fill out the form again. Ah, here you go. And I had just put it out there online that I was, oh, man, I'm trying to get this brand ambassador. I don't know if I'm going to get it. So he reaches out and is like, hey, man, this is my relative. I was like, no, she's real. Yeah, she's real. So he put it to her, showed her some of my stuff. Turns out, fast forward a few weeks, I get a call from marketing at headquarters in Little Debbie, and they're like, hey, this is so-and-so from marketing Little Debbie. I'm like, huh, hi, you know, like total fanboy, like, so you're calling me, huh? That's pretty cool. And he was like, hey, so Little Debbie came down the hallway here from her office and said, I don't know who this guy is or what he does, but I like him and I think we should do something with him. So figure it out. And so he's like, so I'm calling you to figure it out.
Okay.
Like, yes.
Yeah.
So I am a Little Debbie brand ambassador. So occasionally how it kind of works is it's usually me and a bunch of blogger moms that kind of post. Because I've noticed, like, oh, who's the other brand ambassador?
Yeah.
They're all like super popular blogger moms. I'm like, oh. Totally reaching this untouched, demographic of large men.
Yeah.
So
So, I mean, it's a logical fit. It feels to me, like, yeah, honestly, a demographic they should probably pursue even harder than what they do.
I know. It's like, yeah, sure, moms buy the groceries, but these big dudes we're destroying the gas station snacks. Let's be honest.
Right.
We are the market. So, no, it's been really cool. They're an awesome, incredible company. They're very conservative. They're super chill, laid back, a fun brand. And so, yeah, I mean, I'll do some videos for them occasionally or different posts. But honestly, man, it's just like this kind of cool way to, you know, kind of that, like you see sometimes, the work hard, snack hard mentality. Yeah. Like, hey, you can work hard, but also, man, you want to have an oatmeal cream pie? Like, go for it. Enjoy it.
I like the lifting crew, the little Debbie lifting crew, like the flags.
You have to do a double take. Like, is that real? Am I seeing that correctly? Like,
I as you guys know from doing merch and apparel, that's kind of another catalyst. Let's see, for Deadcember year before last, I guess last year. Anyways, whatever year, 2019. I did this shirt, right? So I did a green shirt and it said Debbie's and Deadlifts. And so it had like two Christmas tree cakes on it, bars that crossed each other and said, "Tis the season," right? And so I just made it, right? I literally and I'm not artistic. I literally made it on Illustrator myself. And I was like, oh, this will be fun for my followers. I'll put it out there. And I put it out for sale on my website. Well, sure enough, this had already started with Little Debbie where I was a brand ambassador and I was like, oh, that's no big deal. Well, all of a sudden I'm literally, it's like a Friday afternoon evening and I'm sitting in the deer stand and I'm like, man, finally got out in the woods, got my bow. I am enjoying a Friday afternoon evening in the deer stand. This is great. And all of a sudden my phone rings and it's a phone call from Collegedale, Tennessee. Now in my mind, I was like, oh man, this is Little Debbie headquarters.
Yeah.
What is this? And I'd already kind of freaked out. Like I just released the shirt and I'm like, oh, this is super cool. And then I was like, I didn't get permission. I hope they're cool with it.
Right.
You know?
but
I was in my mind, I'm going, it can't be that bad. It's like, it's something I created on my Adobe Illustrator. So no big deal. And so I'm sitting there and the phone rings and I'm like, you know how it is. I'm like, oh man, I'm in the stand. You're not supposed to answer. You're supposed to be quiet. I'm like, oh, I'm in big trouble, probably. So I'm like, oh, hello? It's like, hey, Dan, this is so-and-so from a Little Debbie headquarters. Hey, we were just going over your shirt you just released with legal counsel. And I'm like, I'm sorry. I didn't know. Like,
I'm sorry. Please. I'm sorry.
I have a wife and kids. Don't do me. I will burn all of them. Please, just no. Just freaking out. You know, he just says the word legal. And I'm like, okay, I'll do it. Like, I'll do it, you know. And he's like, hey, what you can't do what you did. And I'm like, I didn't know, man. It was just something I created just for fun. I designed. He's like, no, it's cool. But you know, it is a trademarked image, is the Christmas tree cake. And I'm like, I didn't know it. It doesn't look like one because I don't think it looks like one. So you can't do that. And I was like, oh, okay. And he's like, but turns out Little Debbie as a company, they're real big into training. They love to train. Like they have their corporate headquarters. They have a big gym,
which is cool.
And the marketing, the sales manager, sales director are from the McKee family and they all love to train. And so he said, so we're sitting in this meeting and we're legal counsel going, hey, he can't do this. We need to send him a cease and desist. We can't do this. We got to do that. And, one of the C-level McKee family goes, well, I get it. I understand he can't do this, but I got to have that shirt.
yeah. That's awesome.
And so at that time I was like, I'll send 20 for free. I'll send 20. Just don't sue me. So that's how Little Debbie Lifting Team was born, was just kind of just some fun apparel that goes out there. And, that they, of course they approve everything that I do and everything that I have to post about some of that. So
yeah.
But that's cool, so man. Cool.
That
awesome
is really
company.
Cool. Yeah, that is really cool. That is so awesome. And it's just like just from our perspective, especially prior to coming across you and your relationship with Little Debbie, that idea to me would be so crazy. It'd be like picking any other random. Any other brand, just right. any brand. Like,
yeah, no, they're into lifting, and they have a partnership with this guy that lifts and was, you know, the best Highland Games, and they have some cool apparel that's based around lifting now. That is just, that is wild.
I know.
Yeah.
It's fun, man, and that's kind of what they had said, is they were like, you know what, you're a good fit because it is different. You know, you're bringing snack cakes into the fitness strength realm, which is something we've never done before. So right. We'll see. Yeah. Hopefully I'm not just a pet project that they enjoy. Hopefully they have some benefit from it.
Yeah.
It's just kind of a fun stuff.
So if we had to make you say, what are your top three Little Debbie snacks?
Oh man. Yeah. The Mount Rushmore. So the Mount Rushmore of Little Debbie is oatmeal cream pie. That's the goat. It's original. Then you also got to put in Nutty Buddies. They'll love those. Honey bun.
Wait a second. Nutty Buddy. Is that the wafer?
Yep.
Okay.
The peanut butter wafer one.
Yes. Yeah. Oh yeah. Okay. Yep. Agreed. Yes.
I love it. It was like, Oh yeah.
That one, we were brushing up on our Little Debbie snack cakes prior, and when we came across that one, I'm like, as soon as I see the picture, I'm like,
it's like the number of those I ate without actually knowing what the actual name was is mind blowing. Yeah.
Dude, I know. I used to get those every day at lunch. I could buy a pack, like the twin pack for 35 cents. And so I was like, man, I'm just going to go get a Little Debbie every day my senior year. And I'm like, man, it's got protein in it. I'm pretty sure. Yeah.
Peanut butter.
It's peanut butter. So that's on the Mount Rushmore. Honey bun is up there. Now you can only get the iced honey bun at the gas station, single serving size. So it depends on how I'm feeling on that day. I like a honey bun. I like an iced honey bun. And then, man, I tell you, underrated. Top four on Mount Rushmore for me is the chocolate cupcake.
Okay.
Really? See, and that's one I've maybe had once in my life.
Yeah. You're also kind of dabbling into one of our future things we're going to talk about with you here soon, is our overrated, underrated segment. So you're also kind of, you just said one of our buzzwords there, underrated. So we do have more for you to come on that. But so you said what's the name on the package for that one?
Chocolate cupcakes.
Okay, chocolate cupcakes. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So they're the ones, there's the chocolate cupcake with the white swirly icing on top, like a single line swirl.
Okay, yep.
Dude, I tell you, this is like the perfect balance of moist cake with the thick chocolate frosting and the cream filling is like lights out.
I'm getting hungry.
Debbie did well.
We were talking right before this. It was like, you know, I don't think I've had very many of, like, you know, there's a pretty wide variety of Little Debbie items to pick from. And I'm like, I don't think I've had most of these. And then you start looking, it's like, well, I ate a lot of Swiss cake rolls as a kid. And also zebra cakes were like a staple in our house and the brownies too. And it's like, actually, you know what? I did eat all of these. I don't know what I'm thinking.
Exactly. And that's the beauty of it is, they're cheap. Like, no offense, I won't name any other brands, but no offense. A lot of them are like twice and three times as expensive. So I was like, man,
right?
For just like as a kid, man, you could go totally. I was a big Star Crunch kid, and so forgotten. Those are those are often overlooked, but that's a solid pickup right there.
My dad, working class man, packed a lunch for work every single day. It just retired after working like the same place for like 45 years. And I can't recall a day in my life that he didn't have one of the Little Debbie snack options in his cooler on the way to work every day. Like that. You can't go wrong.
Backbone of America.
It is. Like, that kind of is a little bit true about Little Debbie. I think it is like a little bit of a backbone of a working class America sort of thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool. I love the Little Debbie thing. That's I was really excited to find out about that, and it did not disappoint. It's maybe even better than what I was hoping for. We've also noticed you've got, I don't know if we'd call him a training partner, someone that's around. You've seen him on Instagram before. Is Maxime Liftoff around, if we're pronouncing his name correctly?
Oh, yeah. Maxime? Yeah, dude, that guy. I tell you what, man. He's... All right. So I've been trying to get him to leave my guest room down here. Hang on just a second. Maxim! Hey! Telephone! Here he comes. In here. He's coming. He's probably. Yeah, just no. Turn it off. No, just here. Just take the phone. Here. 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 Hello there. I'm running very fast up the stairs to make this phone call. How are you guys?
Wow. Well, I didn't know we were getting two guests today, Tanner. This is
bonus. And we understand you're from Russia then.
Oh, yes. Mother country is very nice. Very nice. Yes. Where are you guys from? You sound like you're from America, yes? But you have accent like maybe Minnesota or maybe Canada.
You know, it's somewhere in between. The South Dakota, it's kind of the hybrid of the two.
And we understand you're a bit of a lifter yourself.
Oh, yes. I am anytime Russian champion in lifting of the dead and lots of pressing of the bench.
Yes. And were we saying that right? Is it Maxim Liftoff?
Yeah, it's close. Yes, it's okay. Close.
Our accent could probably use a little work, I'm sure.
And then, what's your family tree? I've heard you refer to your father or your grandfather before.
Oh, yes, grandfather Sergei. He was a great lifter in Russia. I have him. I have many thanks for him. He does great work. He coached me many years. Takes me. My cousin Vladimir. He was strong like bear, but. He is no longer around in family, and I don't know why. But Grandfather Sergei taught me many lessons, like give a man fish, you feed him for one day. You teach man to fish, he no longer deadlifts. Yes. So there's lots of good lessons. My sister is Svetlana, and that girl who warm ups with your Max. Yeah, that's her. That's my sister. So she's a good, strong Russian woman.
Wow, that's great. Do you have, since we got you on the line here, do you have any secret Russian training tips you can share with our listeners?
Oh, I am working. I tell you what, I've been at this house for like 2 months now. This Dan McKim guy, he says he needs help with the lifting of the deads. For this dead symbol, and now he won't let me go. I'm doing all these videos, Russian leans to Russian deadlifts, not Romanian deadlifts. Teaching him how to press up the bench and squat up the bar. I tell you, I don't know. There's lots of things I could say. Man, I'm talking on the phone to your friends. They're asking me many questions, and I'm charging them lots of rubles. Sorry, guys. Go ahead. Dan is trying to get back on the phone. He is,
No, that's all right. We can probably talk. We can probably talk to Dan again now.
Okay. Yes. Hey, put out the oatmeal cream pie. That is mine. Okay, guys. It's nice to see you. Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
You too.
Thank you.
You will be strong again. Yeah. Give me the phone. Sorry, guys. He's ridiculous.
That was quite the treat. We didn't know we were going to get that.
That was a bonus guest.
I wish you could hear it. He's pumping his techno, Russian techno right now, too. Hey, kids are trying to sleep. Would you turn it? Yeah, turn it off. We'll train in the morning.
That brings me to a good plug is if you don't follow Daniel McKim on Instagram, you need to be following. You need, for everyone listening, you need to be following him out there. You put a lot of work into like some of your stuff.
It's really good. It's not just your average lifter's page.
It's not.
You got a lot going on there.
I appreciate it, fellas. It's I'm just kind of a goofy, stupid guy, and so I like creating videos and having some fun because. Man, I feel like our industry, like, as you guys know, because you guys do fun stuff.
We try. And
that's kind of our whole thing. We're not going to do it if it's not fun.
Right.
Yeah. And that's the thing is like, man, I feel like we're so serious in our industry, whether that's you as a coach or as an athlete or as a lifter or whatever it is. It's like, man, we're so serious and so rigid with the things we say and do and how we treat people. It's like, man, we all got into this. When you really take down everything, you really reel it back in. It's like, why did I get into lifting? Because I wanted to get jacked, right? I like getting strong, and I enjoy lifting. And so let's get back to the enjoyment of it and not be so stinking serious and so hard on each other. So, yeah, I appreciate that because I got a lot of stupid stuff out there. I got a lot of videos that just completely – dude, there are times I've learned I never – like any of these stupid videos I do, I never show my wife beforehand. Because okay? Yeah. How it used to go is – I would be editing a video, and I'd be like cackling, giggling like a girl. And she's like, what are you doing? I was like, just wait, honey, wait till I show you this. This is great. I'll show you this video. Yeah. And I would bring her like I was a child that just brought my mom like handpicked flowers. Like, yeah. Mom, I love you so much. Look what I have brought for you. And then she'll watch it and go, yeah, I don't get half of those. Yeah. I don't get any of those jokes. I'm like, because you're not a lifter.
I don't know if I could relate to that any more than what you just explained right there with me and my wife at home. That all just sounds like my life a lot of times.
But at least you have a dude that you probably send stuff to, and yes. You guys can both
yeah.
laugh.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And then look at this. This is going like, to be great.
Ah, it is funny, maybe, yeah. At least to us.
So yeah, that guy thought it was funny yeah. too.
Well, you guys know you got me too. Because I yeah. think it's funny.
There we go.
It is really good though. You put out a lot of good stuff. I really like it. Have you ever? We don't have it. We don't use it. Have you ever thought about having a TikTok account?
You know, I did jump on TikTok.
Okay, you do have it then.
I do have it. It's okay. One of those things with TikTok. I created it, and like people are like, oh man, you should go on TikTok. It's great. And I was like, I went on there and I got like 4 views.
Yeah.
And like the only thing I got were spam bots. And I'm like, okay. Yeah, this is stupid. So I got back on here recently and I'm just putting my stuff in there. But
well, a lot of your different. Videos kind of feel like they could be
they
good
fit
TikTok,
the TikTok
videos
format
too.
A little bit.
Yeah.
I appreciate that. Some of them, it's weird, you know, how TikTok is. I have some videos that a couple on TikTok that have, you know, way more, you know, I've got, this is what's weird. I can even pull it up while I'm talking here. I think I've got one where I did strongmen when they meet, and it's got like 190,000 views. Right. I'm like, oh, that's cool. And then I post another video and it has 300.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Wait a right. second.
Is there a middle
the algorithm? What is this?
Yeah, that's true. And it's even true within Instagram also, where you can be so, you'll be like, oh man, this one is so great. People mm-hmm. are going to love it. It does terrible. And the next one, you're like, yeah, this one might be okay. And it's like the best one you've ever had.
Dude, isn't that so frustrating? I do that all the time.
You can't predict. You no. really can't predict.
It's so hard because I'll spend this time editing a video and I'm like, wow, this is going to hit. I tell you what, man, I'm so proud of this. And then it flops. And then I have ones the same way. I have ones where I'm like, dude, this is so bad. I don't even want to post it. But I got to have a video this week. I put it out there.
Yeah.
And it does really well. I don't get it.
Yeah. I think it goes back to you just got to keep doing stuff. I mean, that's really the only thing you can control. Just keep putting stuff out.
Yep.
What have you guys found has been great for you? Has it been consistency? Has yeah. it been like, do you flood the feed with more stuff, or has it been like take a break, take a week off and then put stuff on there? Like, what's been the best for you guys?
I mean this is what we do, whether it's right or wrong. What our thing is, it's consistency in the way that we basically post 2 things a day every single day forever, you know, not really, yeah. really never more than that. And really never less than that. And that's just kind of, you know, but there again, at times it seems to work, at times it seems to probably not work. So, but our thought is if we're at least staying consistent in that way, we're going to hit on some cylinders at some points in time. I get concerned if we just never don't post twice a day.
Yeah.
Just essentially, there's just always 2 things a day, whether that's the right frequency or not. That's just kind of where we landed with what is manageable too. I mean, I suppose you could do more, but I feel like if you're posting too frequently, you're, you know, cannibalizing yourself too, which I get concerned about. All in all, I guess that's a long way of saying we really don't have any idea, but that's just is what we do.
That's what we do, and we don't know why we do it.
That sounds way better than me, because I'm like, I probably should post today.
Right.
It's tough.
You mentioned Deadcember. So how long have you been leading the charge on that then? How many years?
Oh man, this was my third year of writing it.
Okay, so you write the program for Deadcember.
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
That's cool. We have a couple we have Massonomics Gym, which is our small little club strength gym that we run out of Aberdeen here in South Dakota.
Yeah.
We don't have very many members. We have a really small membership, but we had a couple people that participate in Squattober every year, and then we had a couple of members that participated in Deadcember this year. And I know we had two that did Deadcember. One hit a very large deadlift PR at the end of it. He hit a 661-pound deadlift, I think, Big Jake did, which was a big mile. You know, that's the 300-kilo deadlift. That's a really cool one. And then I think Big John at the gym did it too. And I think he might have hit a PR too. I don't know what it was. But I know for Jake it was a big PR. And so I got to quiz him about how he liked the programming at the end of the month. And, I mean, I guess his answer too was the proof was in the pudding. It worked for him. So it's hard to say he didn't like it.
That's awesome. I appreciate that. That's because it's one of those things where you're trying to program for, and you guys know this better than I do. You're trying to program something for lots of different people of different walks of life doing different things. And man, I tell you what, we did every year you can put your numbers up because I kind of see the feedback too. And so people will put their comments in there. And you wouldn't believe the comments you get, like people like, oh man, I only PR'd by 10 pounds. I wish this had been a harder program. I'm bro.
Yeah, only
in PR, like should never really be in the same sentence.
And for a month.
This wasn't
a 6 month program.
I mean, I've so many people that we've been around that lift with for a long time. Like you claw and scratch and do anything you can to just like over the course of years at times, like get some sort of
everything like somehow perfectly goes your way for months on end.
Yeah.
And you get lucky and end up with a 5 pound PR. Yeah, and it's like a smashing success.
Yeah.
I know. And you run around all stacked, you know? Right. Oh yeah. And my favorite too is people like the comment, you know, like, yeah, I pulled a 90-pound PR. It was a good month. I'm like, okay, you clearly guess things a little wrong here. Right, so, you have the wide range. Then, of course, my favorite is people like, well, I feel like the neurological load of the month was better, you know, hindrance by these days and that days. I'm like, I'm just trying not to kill you.
Yeah,
like you're deadlifting, and that was the hard part, right? It's like, okay, how do I program this to where we're pulling 5 days a week? I know my back will be trash. So how do I protect myself? And it's hard, you know, it's like, I had to try to tell people like, hey man, this is a general strength program. Do the best you can, set your numbers. You can, if you need to bump them up cause it's too easy. Great. If it's too hard, you need to back it off a little bit, but it's been so cool, man. And I think that's what's awesome is the community it's built and how supportive people are for that month. And they're cheering each other on, and you just kind of get that team feeling where I think sometimes, especially in COVID, right, you don't feel like you're part of a team or you're not around people. And so it was really cool this year to see people kind of rally around each other and cheer each other on and do it together.
Yeah, that is cool. And you partner, or you do that with Sorenex. Sorenex is a big part of Deadcember and Squattober, correct? Or that's kind of they're involved and okay.
And so how would you describe then, like, what is, if someone was asking, like, what is your role with Sorenex?
Sure. I'm the Midwest rep. So I live in Northwest Missouri and I cover the Midwest. It's kind of my territory of sales. And I specialize mostly in high school, college, and pro teams is who I kind of deal with. And also private facilities as well. But that's kind of my focus market.
So it wouldn't be unreasonable for you to need to make a trip to Western Northeast South Dakota and, you know,
we do have two colleges in town right, too. Yeah, so you could make
it. Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
I don't see why I wouldn't make it to
gym. It's a Mecca up here, you know,
yeah.
Eastern, Western, Northern, Southern, South Dakota.
Don't forget your compass when you come.
Yeah, he's like, I'm pretty sure I'm either in the Bermuda Triangle or I'm at Massonomics. I don't know where I'm at.
Right. That is right. So we do, I mentioned it earlier, we do have our overrated, underrated game. You might not be familiar with it, but here's what it is. We pick a special
set of Daniel McKim topics for overrated, underrated. And it's your job and responsibility to decide whether each one is overrated or underrated. And the most important part to remember is you can't ride the line on in between. Ooh. You have to pick a side. And I lied. That's not the most important part. The most important part to remember is that this is scored and judged. And we let you know.
Pass or fail grade. Yeah, it's a pass or fail.
Yes, right. And there's several different awards and things on the line here that we could get to at the end. But it is a very important game.
Good.
Okay.
I'm in.
Okay. So
over or underrated. See?
Yeah,
underrated game.
You get it. Yeah. Okay. Overrated or underrated kilts?
Oh man. I gotta go, they're underrated. Dude, if you've not worn a kilt and felt the breeze, then you're missing out. Underrated.
I agree. I have a kilt myself, and I love any opportunity I can have to wear my kilt.
Yep. Unfortunately for my wife, we met and were married before I got into the Highland Games, or else I probably would have worn a kilt to our wedding, or at least I would have tried, and she would have probably stormed out. But it would have been cool.
Yes, yes, it would be cool.
Yeah.
Major cool points for that one, for sure, for anyone that's got to do that.
Is that guy from America?
He seems so cultured.
She married a guy from Europe, I think.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. Overrated or underrated deadlift bars?
Oh, deadlift bars, I feel personally are overrated. Now, people are going to hate that, but I've pulled lots on I've pulled deadlift bars numerous times, and I just don't like the whip. I don't like the I pull more on a straight bar than I do a deadlift bar, which is bad. So I feel like sometimes deadlift bars can be cheating. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
No, that's fair.
Yeah.
What's kind of just in your training anymore in a nutshell? What do you kind of do? I mean, do you have goals in mind or how do you approach your training generally speaking?
Oh man, it's now that I've done throwing, the heaviest I ever weighed is I got up to over 310. And so I usually competed around 295 to 305. Right. And so I've realized I don't need to be that heavy, but it's hard sometimes. Right. So I got down before December to like 275, and then December came around and I put it up over 290, you know, got up to 290.
Yep.
But I was pulling heavier. It felt great. But I tell you what, man, it's hard. Sometimes I'm like, there's sometimes I was laying in bed and I'm like, you know what? I'm going to do it 330. Let's just crank up the body weight. Yeah. You're 39, but it doesn't matter. Let's just do it. You never done it before. See what happens. And I'm like, I go to bed. I'm like, yeah, we're going to do it. And then I wake up in the morning. I'm like, I look in the mirror. I'm like, nah.
Yeah.
Nah, it's not a good idea.
Who was that guy?
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And it's usually, you kind of tell that to one of your buddies. They're like, bro, yeah, you totally should do that.
Yeah.
Dude, you'd be so huge. I know, right? Yeah. Man, can you imagine what you would pull? I know. Yeah. And then you have that conversation, and then you talk to your wife, and she's like, nah, yeah, please don't. Yeah.
That's all.
So really right now it's like
my friends, I think too.
Yeah. So I don't know. Right now I just kind of, I just am a meathead. I love to train. So I try to change it up and do different things, but it is different now without having something to compete and go after. So yeah, it's always a dance.
Right on. Overrated or underrated Braveheart the movie?
Oh, how could you underrate one of the highest rated movies of all time? And how could you say it's overrated unless you're Irish? I got to go with underrated. Braveheart's underrated.
It is a classic.
Yeah, it is. I haven't seen it for a little while. It's almost like when I'd be ready to rewatch.
Yeah.
Mel Gibson at his finest.
It is. Have you ever seen The Patriot with Mel Gibson?
Yes, definitely.
Very similar.
Yeah.
Well, they make that movie again in a different country. You know,
it kind of didn't even dawn on me until now. Like, yeah, that is a very similar movie.
It's like, this worked before. Let's do it again.
I never crossed.
Let's add Heath Ledger and do it again.
Never connected those dots.
I know, right? Somebody kind of ruined it for me. The other, it was a couple weeks ago, and we were talking. I was like, yeah, Patriots on Amazon Prime. I was like, yeah, I know. I watched it. I was like, yeah, it's like the American version of Braveheart. I was like, what? Huh? What? It was almost like partly ruined it and partly made it really cool.
That really is a good comparison.
Yeah.
I'm like, no, he was fighting for his freedom. Wait a second.
Yeah, right.
Did he have a family member die?
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's good. Okay. Last one, and we usually save the most important ones for last. I'm just going to say one small change to this because we already covered something. So we'll do a slightly altered most important last topic. Overrated or underrated Swiss cake rolls?
Ooh. They are underrated. Okay. Now, why they're underrated, because I don't know if people always know how to eat them, right? Mm. My brother used to drive me crazy. For some reason, I told you I was a Star Crunch guy. He was a Swiss roll guy. And he used to eat it by layers.
Yeah.
And I was like, bro, just shove it in your mouth. Yeah. It's amazing. Just, and he's like, no, man, I got to enjoy it. And as I've gotten older, like, eating it by layers is very satisfying. You put it in the fridge, it's really good.
So you would recommend the layer approach then?
I would. I came to my senses and I got older and matured. I saw what he was doing, and yeah, it's pretty good. See, now, I will tell you, have you had the zebra cake rolls?
I've never had the zebra. I didn't know that existed until we were looking before that there was a roll version of that.
Guys, it's awesome. You guys are digging the zebra cakes, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Love them.
You got to get them. Imagine a Swiss roll, only almost twice as big, but it's made of zebra cakes.
What about this? On the Swiss cake roll, you know that white piece of, I don't know if it's cardboard or plastic that the Swiss cake rolls rest on. When you take the cake rolls off of it, and there's that little bit of chocolate that's still on that piece of plastic, do you find a way to eat that, or do you throw it away?
How did I know you're going
there? I mean, everyone has everyone knows what I'm talking about. What I just
dirty
described,
details.
What
here.
I described. If you've had one of those, you've at least thought like you've had to make that decision before. I think, right?
Yeah, anyone of any substantial body weight.
If you're someone that generally doesn't leave food on your plate, that you have to make that you have to cross a bridge there.
Everyone who's ever like, hey bro, you want your cardboard? I'm just thinking me as my brothers. I know that we've done that. Like you take the cardboard, and of course that's the first thing you do is you rake it on your teeth, right?
Yep.
Like,
hey. Yep.
And you get that. And if you toss it and don't do that, myself from one of my brothers, I have two brothers, it'd be like, you grab it and you would do it. You're like, bro, you're just going to leave
you,
that?
Yeah, you missed the best part. Yeah.
Yeah, you missed it. Yeah. Oh my goodness.
No part
that's
of the
a good
Swiss
call.
Cable
that is such a,
waste.
Like, fat guy. I mean, that is a,
that's we would call that a fat hack. Yeah.
It's a fat hack for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, that's hilarious.
If you haven't done that before, you really aren't living. Yeah, right. If you haven't scraped the little bit of chocolate off the cardboard with your teeth, off the Swiss cake roll. Yeah.
Because you can't get it with your tongue or your fingers. No. It's gotta be with your teeth. Yeah.
The direct access. Yeah.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so I guess, did he pass?
We are happy to announce you did pass.
Okay, great.
Nice. What ones did you guys disagree with?
Let's see, Swiss cake roll, I'm good on that. Braveheart. Braveheart's tough because it is rated so highly. You could make the argument.
I feel like that one leaves the most room for debate. Yeah.
I really like the movie. Yeah. There's no doubt about that. And then Kilts, you said I really like Kilts. I think they're underrated.
And I do think deadlift bars are a little overrated.
Yeah, and I'm someone that likes to use a deadlift bar, but I think they have their place and time still, and I think they generally get a little bit overrated. So I kind of agree for the most part, I think.
Nice. So if you guys are sitting down to watch a dude movie and you have to choose between Braveheart Gladiator, and The Patriot. Which one are you putting in?
Oh, I did just watch The Gladiator like a month or two ago, too. So
I watched Patriot a month or two ago, so that takes Patriot off the table just because I've seen it more recently. And between the other two, I haven't seen Gladiator for a while, but I do really like Gladiator. So my answer would be Gladiator, Russell Crowe.
I'd be torn between Gladiator and Braveheart. I almost go the other way, or kind of what you just said, actually, Tanner, is that I did just watch Gladiator, so I might switch it to Braveheart. But
what's a better line? Are you not? What is?
Are you not entertained?
Are you not entertained? Or what is Mel Gibson in Braveheart when he does the speech on the front line when he's getting everyone revved up? What's a better scene there, do you think?
Ooh, I don't know. I love the "Are you not entertained?" Right. Because I think I've said it like in joking to people a lot.
Yeah,
like you do something stupid, you're like, "Are you not entertained?"
That one line is really impactful.
Yeah.
Yep.
But what's Braveheart? Aren't they like, but they can never take our freedom? Isn't that, does they say something like that?
Freedom, that is the line, you know? Right.
That's a hard one.
Yeah.
But I feel like if you could watch Braveheart, like you said, you're watching Patriot, so.
Well, that's two birds, one stone in that scenario, then, actually. You get to watch two movies for the price of one.
Oh, man, watch them come out with some other movie. Mel Gibson in The Canadian Mountie. It's like, fuck a second. I think I've seen this before.
True. Well, Daniel, that does kind of wrap up most of what we wanted to talk to you about. This is a great episode. We've been excited to have you on for a while. I'm really glad we got to do it. I think all your content and everything you're doing is awesome. I think anyone that's listening and not following you yet needs to be following along with everything that you're doing.
Oh, well, I appreciate you guys. It's I've watched and been impressed by your guys' stuff for a while now. So I appreciate it. It's an honor to be on, and thanks for the laughs. This is a good time.
Yeah, it was awesome.
It was a lot of fun. Yeah.
All right, you the man. Thanks, Dan.
Thanks, Dan.
Thanks, guys.
See ya.
See ya.
Well, Tanner.
Tommy, what do you officially give that?
I think we officially go, what? Cool beans. Cool beans. Cool beans. We got too many knobs up here.
So he did get the double cool beans.
He did get the double cool beans.
Very cool beans. That was, he's a really fun guy, I think. And I don't mean a mushroom.
Okay.
Fun guy.
We got to meet his Russian friend as well.
Yes. So. Maxim Liftov.
Yeah.
Am I saying that right?
Maxim Liftov.
Okay, yeah, okay. I know I'm kind of always getting that wrong. It's my northeast South Dakota.
Yeah, it doesn't speak Russian.
No, right, exactly.
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah. He's got a lot of cool stuff going on.
Uh-huh.
I think he does need to make the trip up here. I mean, he can make the excuse that he's the Midwestern sales rep, and who's more Midwestern than northeast South Dakota?
Some potential clients just waiting to give him money.
We're right smack dab Midwest as they come. We are probably only about 6 hours from him then, though, it sounds like.
Probably about that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool beans.
Very,
very cool beans. So we did talk about our contest that we have coming up. That was one of the other highlights of this episode, the meme contest. Get your post out there sometime over this week that you're listening to this. Use the hashtag Massonomics meme. Tag us, and you could be a winner.
Yeah. Do a lot of entries. Why stop at just one when you could do 2, 3, 4, 5, or even 10?
Don't stop. Can't stop. Won't stop.
Yeah.
Sign up to be a Massonomics podcast supporting member. We have had more supporting members come in, and that frees us up the opportunity to... I don't know, what's something we would do if we got more supporting members? Buy cool stuff that we like?
Maybe do some more mass market ideas. Yeah. I don't know. We'll come up with a good... Just give us the money. We'll figure out a home for it.
You don't worry about what we're going to do with the money.
That's our job, just to get figure us it out.
The money. We promise it'll be worth your while. We'll figure that. Your money's in good hands with
it
us.
It is. It is in good hands.
So you can sign up to be a supporting member at the four different...
Tanner, it's like it's the opposite of J.G. Wentworth.
Right. It's your money. We need it now. Yeah. It's your money. We need it now. Yes. Yeah. We are the opposite of J.G. Wentworth.
Is that G.J. Wentworth then?
That's the direct opposite. Yes. That's the alternative universe version, which is us. Leave us a review. We've got well over 300. We are the way we phrase that, we're not actually on the road to 400. We're on the road to 400 yes. right now. Yeah,
very early stages of the road to the road.
We don't like to really start that too early, like get people too revved up on it when.
Yeah, I mean, like, whoa, we just hit one milestone here. Right, like, right. Calm down, guys. Not like all
we actually ones. Haven't even really done the thing yet that we're going to do because of this thing, so we can't do another thing.
Yeah,
yet
you got to give us a second here. We have lives. Come on.
But do go leave us a review. Tell your friends about the podcast if this is your first time listening. If you saw if Daniel McKim shared something about this episode and you checked it out and this is your first one, check out all of our old episodes. We've got 253 before this. So
a few afternoons worth of entertainment just sitting waiting.
And we've probably got 253 more to come after this. So make sure to subscribe. Subscribe on YouTube. Mm-hmm. Like us on Facebook. Listen to me read these closing ads before I forget. Today's show was brought to you by Spud Ink Straps. Their goal is to make products that support sports performance and help everyone achieve their training goals. They make products that last forever, won't bust your budget, and most importantly, leave no doubt about success when everything is on the line. Make sure to check them out online at spud-ink-straps.com. And this episode is also brought to you by Hybrid Performance Method. They're your one-stop shop for all things fitness and online coaching. Whether your goals are training-related, nutrition and body composition-related, or both, Hybrid has a program for you. With dedicated and experienced coaches in each strength and fitness discipline, you can rest assured that you're in the very best hands possible. Use our discount code with them. It's MASS, M-A-S-S, in all caps for 5% off any training or nutrition membership for the life of your membership. Visit hybridperformancemethod.com. This episode is also brought to you by Texas Power Bars. In 1980, Buddy Capps set out on his own to make what he believed was the greatest bar he had ever seen and trained with, and the Texas Power Bar was born. It was strong as a house with the best knurling, and it was maintenance-free. Do you think Maxim Liftoff would think the Texas Power Bar is the greatest?
Well, he might have some Russian guy. Yeah. Know, he has some secret Russian bar.
But in Texas Power Bar's defense, hundreds of state, national, international, and world powerlifting records and Russian powerlifting records have been and continue to be set and broken on the Texas Power Bar. To learn more about their bars, visit them at texaspowerbars.com. And today's show is brought to you by Lifting Large. Lifting Large has set a new standard for customer service within the strength world. They have live website chat support and speedy email responses. Lifting Large is home to the Groundlock Deadlift Slipper. So if you're getting ready for December next year, get yourself
get
a pair
a
of
jumpstart
yeah,
on
Groundlock
it.
Deadlift Slippers. Yes, they're always in stock and ready to ship. Maxonomics listeners can save 20% on all Lifting Large branded products like that. Chalk bowl. Someone shared that they bought one.
Ooh,
based on the Mastomics recommendation, I bought one of these and saved 20% by using code MAST20 at checkout, and you could do the same.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, sponsors. Tommy, where do they find you at?
You can find me at Tomahawk_D.
Find me at Tanner_Baird, but much more importantly, make sure to follow Mastonomics at Mastonomics.
See ya.